Hi, my name is Kevin Thomas, W1DED. I'm back with the contest crew. We had a Ask the Crew set of questions last week, and we're back again to finish those questions off. So jumping right into it, the first question, how much do you analyze your contest experience aside from the QSOs and points?
Well, not as much now as I used to. I can remember when I first started spending hours looking at the log and breaking it down by hour and by band, and then I had a very good friend, K5GN, and after the sweepstakes, we would get on the phone and just talk about what happened every hour and what we were doing, who we were working, different things that we ran into in the contest. And now I've done it so much that I'm not trying to learn the ins and outs as much, just look at the rate sheet after the contest and kind of see how it looks compared to some of the other guys.
This is something that I do a lot of, and it kind of depends on, you know, what the contest is, what my goal is for the next contest. I've been doing a lot of contests this year from ND7K in Arizona, and honestly, the propagation from there is pretty straightforward. You know, you work Europe in the morning, JA in the afternoon. I don't spend a lot of time analyzing logs for that particular contest, because it's my home area. You know, I know the propagation here quite well. So I don't spend a ton of time. Now, when I'm operating from other places, like from ZF1A, I do spend a lot of time analyzing logs and whatnot prior to the next contest. Actually, just yesterday, I spent a good 2 hours looking at my CQ Worldwide CW log from last year from ZF1A, because we are getting ready to prepare for a multi-single this year at ZF1A. And it's my job to make sure that, you know, we put the best score on possible, and I need to really understand when the bands are opening to different regions of the world. So what I was really paying close attention to yesterday was I'm trying to remind myself, you know, what time does 10 meter open to JA? What time was I running on 10 meters in the morning to Europe? You know, I was looking at all those things as preparation, because, you know, our main goal for that particular contest is that we're going to have a really good team down there, and we want to set the multi-single record for North America. And the only way that that can really happen is to be super prepared. And that's something that I've been working on. But that, again, it always depends on what the contest is and who your competition is. Sometimes I spend a lot of time, sometimes a little time.
Yeah, and this question, I don't know if it means aside from what Dan's doing, but full contest experience, I look at that a lot more recently because I'm trying to build a station. So, you know, does my MOAS file work? Does my, you know, switching setup that I thought was great in theory, does it actually work in practice? Did this hardware I put up actually work? I do more of that now than the log analyzing. And honestly, that's actually a lot more work, because you can analyze the logs. You don't have to act on it until the next contest. Figuring out if your hardware is what it should be, you got to diagnose any station problems. That's way more time consuming.
So I'm looking at this from a couple of perspectives. So first of all, I have to say, you know, our resident, I guess, ND7K official, ND7K and ZF1A official log analyzer is Scott K7ZO. And a lot of times, you know, we'll send the log off to him. He'll, you know, and out will come a, you know, several page PowerPoint deck of, you know, consisting of, oh, well, you know, this is what changed from last year. This is what we probably should have, you know, focused on a little more strategy wise. So that's sort of one thing. And, you know, Scott really helps us a lot with sort of that analysis. But more often than that, yes, I'm looking at things like, you know, were all the, you know, various technical functions working as we expected? Were they helping or were they hurting? Were they a distraction? I'm sort of looking for the anecdotes from the, you know, the operators of, you know, this drove me crazy. Wouldn't it be nice if we had another antenna pointing at South America or something like that, or, you know, we were interfering with each other, and just kind of keeping it in mind for the next contest. That's really, you know, there's a lot that goes into that. And, you know, yeah, sure, there are contests where I don't do any of that work. I just sort of show up and operate. But if, you know, it's just the gamut between serious and not.
The one thing I have noticed is there's a tendency to do much more analysis when you lose than when you win. So when you win, you're like, well, hey, I won, this is great. But I've probably spent more time really thinking about a contest when I came in second or third, and I'm trying to figure out, okay, what did I miss? What did I not do right? Or what can I do better the next time? Where did that guy beat me? That kind of thing. So just human nature, I guess, but something I've seen over and over again, at least in my own experience.
I guess I'm also thinking of this question from an intermediate contester's standpoint, and maybe this is a chance for someone to give you a call, Randy, and take you up on your coaching post-contest.
Well, yes, I mean, if you think about it, right, you're right. We kind of immediately focus on QSOs and points and breakdowns and that kind of stuff or technical issues. But, you know, log checking reports, like we talked about in some of the previous shows, are a really important thing to look at and try to figure out what kind of mistakes you're making, that type of stuff. It's a complex multi-dimensional game. We've got multiple bands. We've got time constantly moving and shifting. Even though we know sunrise and sunset's probably the same from one contest year to the next, still the demographics change a little bit depending on what's going on. And so depending on conditions. So there's always things that you can learn and be aware of. And things like Dan pointed out, when do bands open? You know, we know when sunrise is. Does the band open right at sunrise? Does it open a little later? Does it open really good? And probably more than anything else, is there someplace else I should be? Maybe being there right when the band open isn't always the right thing. So anyway, lots of things to look at.
You know, I almost look at other people's logs more than I do, you know, ours. Like I'll especially if it's a new contest and I don't quite know what I'm doing yet, and you know, I'm just trying to figure out like, okay, what were the best scores in this area in the last couple of years? And you don't want to just go to last year because you kind of need to figure out, okay, well, what were the similar stations at the time, and what were the, you know, can you sort of figure out like what were the similar solar conditions, you know, and what was the strategy for that? You know, like go back, you know, 11 years or whatever it might be, and just sort of figure out, okay, at the peak of the sunspot cycle, what were they doing? When were they going to 10 meters? When were they working, you know, these stations? And that's that, you know, I if you do that like right before, you know, the week before a contest or the month before a contest, you're going to come in a lot more prepared, especially if you sort of write down a plan.
Dan mentioned they're going for the multi-single record at ZF1A. So immediately I went to cqww.com and went to records, went to North America and to see who has the record. It's VP2E. And
you guys are going after VP2E record.
VP2E was the sideband one, so we're gearing up for CW. But your point's still valid, Randy, though.
But anyway, what did I do? So I go there and I see what the records are, and then I click on the listing that shows me all the top scores of all time, and I see the one that Chris and I did last year is number 3, and then I expanded to see the band breakdowns because I wanted to see, well, what was different in the VP2E year versus V47 in 2015 versus last year. And so by looking at the band breakdowns, you can kind of see, oh, well, they had more multipliers on these bands or more QSOs here or there, that kind of thing. So there's plenty of data out there. And with public logs, you can really drill down and go nuts on some of this stuff. But this is how you kind of get ready for a contest. As you're starting to prepare a goal, you look at what have people done in the past and then try to build a benchmark for yourself that you can then chase.
And one good thing about our experience at ZF1A is that we actually did this contest multi-single 2 years ago, and we came really close to the record that time. And so now we have this this log that we can follow during the contest that we know that we came real close to that record. We just got to beat that score just a little bit to finally get the record in our hands. But we have this blueprint that we can follow, which is this log. I feel like we did really well in that contest. We just got to do just a tiny bit better. But you better believe it, throughout that contest, we're going to have that log open. And we're going to be like, okay, 2 years ago, what were we doing at this time? And we can see it. And, you know, if what we're doing right now isn't working, like, well, let's say 2 years ago, we were around 20 meters at this time. Why don't we go to 20? And that's all, you know, publicly available information. That's something that we definitely keep an eye on while we're doing the contest, too.
Moving on to the next question, I thought this was a sort of interesting question the way it's sectioned off. How old were you when you decided to make serious contesting a part of your life? And then the really important part of this question, I think, is there time for someone starting late? I know that most of you guys started probably as teenagers, and you've been doing it for decades. So I'm really curious to hear what you have to say about this.
You know, I was a no-code tech when I was, you know, first got out, and I was largely idle in the hobby for years. I was actually, you know, I saw this question on a list, and I was trying to figure out. It looks like I was maybe 32 or so. I'm, you know, 39 now. This was 7 years ago. I decided to, you know, get really involved in contesting, mostly because I didn't know, you know, I didn't know how much fun it was, and maybe didn't have the means at the time. And you know, when the bug bit, it bit pretty hard, and it was one of these things where I was kind of looking for, you know, something to sink some energy into. And you know, just like anything, when you sort of figure out, like, okay, this is a lot of fun, and I want to you know, do really well with it. Well, you start, you know, finding other people that are similarly passionate about it. You know, I met Dan, I met Chris, met you know, a bunch of people, and started sort of figuring out, like, okay, you know, how can I get more involved? How can I start, you know, operating with some of these guys? What is it that they need that would, you know, make it appealing for me to be involved with them? You know, like, you know, a lot of them are need help with technical stuff. So, okay, I'll spend some time learning that and maybe become a technical resource rather than just an operating one. And Exchange, they help me with operating all the time. So, I don't know that, you know, I don't know when too late's too late. I, you know, that's sort of, I wouldn't, that's really up to you. I mean, I would say that the main, you know, there's a couple of main things that are going to be limiting factors. One, you know, it's not a cheap hobby. I mean, it can be, but it's, you know, like traveling to these places and so forth, you know, can be expensive. There's also just a huge time commitment, like anything. You know, if you're going to get good at it, and you're going to, you know, spend time during the week when you're not doing it practicing, if you're going to, you know, really put any effort into taking it seriously, if you're battling other priorities like work and family and others, it is going to slow you down compared to somebody who doesn't have, you know, any of those, I mean, I would call them roadblocks. I mean, there's nothing wrong with that. It's totally respectable to go that way. And I would even discourage people from, you know, shutting out everything else in their life and only doing contesting. There's no way you're going to, you know, make a profit that way. So, you know, life is balance.
I think, you know, for me, it was between 16 and 18 years old. I started to get more proficient, and I remember doing a CW sprint, and K3LR emailed me and said, "Hey, you did good in the sprint. Come on out for a contest sometime." And I'm like, "Oh, all right." I'm like 17-year-old kid from Alaska. What are you talking about? And then I set up this crude SO2R setup at home for an ARRL CW from Alaska. I mean, it was awful, and I did pretty well. It was great because it was a captive audience. And then that's when Tim said, "All right, you need to come out." And then when I realized I was flying from Alaska to Pennsylvania for a contest, it was like, "All right, well, I guess I'm kind of into this now." And is there a time for someone starting late? The cool thing about ham radio is you don't have to be in really great shape to do it, right? You know, you're not running a marathon. If you can sit down at a desk, you can take it serious. So yeah, you can start anytime you want. I think it's awesome. A lot of people pick it up after they retire. I think you can take it up anytime. There's no bad reason to wait.
So I got licensed when I was 13. I fell into contesting right from the beginning. And I was pretty intent about it, even, you know, when I was 15, 16 years old. My first guest stop was at K5PFL, who later became K5NA. Was the first time I got to really use a big station, single op, high power, and that kind of got me hooked. And then I've just been chasing ham radio. So I kind of went to college on the ham radio contesting degree and got an engineering degree as my minor. But I have had this conversation with other people in the past, and there's no question those hours and hours and hours that you have when you're in high school, in college, to play radio just full on without having to worry about going to work or, you know, just deal with making a living or taking care of a family or whatever. Those hours definitely build your skills. It's kind of the 10,000 hours thing in another form. So it is, I have noticed it is hard for guys who start later to catch up, but it's really just because, it's not because they can't, it's just hard to overcome all those hours of experience of just hearing things and recognizing what's going on.
Yeah, so for me, you guys have to realize that when I was, you know, 4 years old, 5 years old, you know, my father's a ham and we had multi-singles happening here at my house. And so that's what I grew up with. And I'm very motivated for whatever reason to try and beat other people. Currently it's Chris, as we all know. But back when I was a kid, my brother was a ham too. He still is, KK6BB. He'll show up on the air every once in a while. But I always had to, you know, my goal was always to beat him and everything when I was really young. And so, you know, I got my license when I was 8 because he got his when he was 9. And, you know, I started contesting the first weekend I had my license, and it's basically never stopped since then. So it's been a serious part of my life, literally since I was like 5 years old. And then as far as starting late, I think Bill is the perfect example for that. And thanks for sharing your little story there, because he even though he's relatively young, he got started relatively late and he's doing a great job at this point. And I really don't think there is a time where it's too late. There's lots of guys that are retired and start up now. And not everybody has to get into this hobby, even contesting, to try and be the best in the world. It's just not feasible. But a lot of guys have a lot of fun with this hobby, just getting on and working, guys. And there's never a time that's too late to do that.
Next question. Share a contest experience where you thought disaster was about to strike, but in the end, everything worked out okay.
Yeah, I was going to go with our Russia story. You might need to back me up on this.
Oh, but my gosh.
So me and Chris are doing WRTC in Russia in 2010. And they had warned us that there might be some thunderstorms in the area. And they kept telling us that if there's going to be any thunderstorms, they're going to stop the contest for all the contestants. And we're just going to wait them out. Well, it turns out these thunderstorms are very spotty and only a few of us were affected by them, but they were like right over us. And I can't tell you how many times I looked over at Chris and I'm like, what the hell are we doing? There's like lightning like right outside of our window. Shouldn't we stop?
Wait, we're in a tent in a field.
Yeah, it was super crazy. And then, I just remember the rain was coming down so hard. And it started like coming in sideways through the tent and like all of our equipment was getting wet. Like, I don't know how nothing broke. Everything was fine in the end. But like, that was like it was actually kind of scary because I kept looking at Chris and like, if lightning hits, are we going to die? And he's like, I'm not sure. Let's just keep going. And I'm like, okay, we're going to do it.
So. Well, our referee said, if it's bad, they'll shut you down. I'm like, it's bad. It's like, well, we're not going to stop because nobody else is stopping, but we might die. So it'll be fine. In 2016, was that the hurricane auto year, Dan, 2016? I think so.
Yeah, I think so.
I think so. So I was in Costa Rica, and Costa Rica had not had a hurricane in like 158 years. And I got an email from my airline that said, oh, there's a hurricane hitting. You need to reschedule. And I'm like, oh, my gosh, seriously? So instead of canceling my trip, I rescheduled it so I could get there when the hurricane hit and called my boss. Anyway, I get there, I get picked up, we start the contest, and the hurricane, the eye of it went right over the QTH, like right over it. It's raining, it's windy, it's pouring rain, and I got the headphones on. I have no idea what's going on. I can't hear on the radio because there's so much lightning. And I remember one time on Saturday, Cam taps me on the shoulder and he says, hey man, if I tap you on the shoulder and say we have to go, I need you to throw the headphones down and we have to go. And I'm like, okay, should I just leave now? He's like, no, keep operating. But if I tell you we have to go, you got to run to the car and we got to go. I'm like, all right, that's kind of sketchy, but okay. Don't hear anything. Next day, Sunday, I'm operating. And he's like, hey, we're going to be gone for a while. If you need something, call me. All right, whatever. Finish the contest. Turns out, up above the mountain from us was like a reservoir for the aquifer for the city. And there was so much rain that it was going to break the dam on it and that was going to open up and literally wash the QTH away. And come to find out, tragically, the city flooded, the entire town got wiped out, people died. It was actually extremely tragic. We couldn't get out on time for my flight because the road was closed because it was gone. Anyway, 158 years, hurricane hit right over TI-5W, and we were like this close to having to evacuate because the QTH might have been gone. So that was awful, but it worked out.
I think this questioner was thinking about an amp that quit or something, not a full-on disaster.
This is, well,
this is way more dramatic.
So that same WRTC that Dan talked about, we were a few miles away in another tent, W2SC and I, and we saw the thunderstorms happening. They kind of passed close to us, but not over us, but we were kind of in the same place and just decided, okay, we're just going to keep going. There's nothing to be gained by stopping. It's either going to happen or it's not. But my story is from the same WRTC. When we were setting up, you know, you have a million wires in these things. It's called wireless, but you've got all these wires for coaxes, and you've got all these special switch boxes to be able to have the antenna switch automatically and handle the audio and all this other kind of stuff. And for some reason, I don't know whether I plugged in the wrong thing or Tom did, but we plugged in something and we blew up a component. And it was a really critical one. And it was just a case we put 12 volts at a place there wasn't supposed to be 12 volts. And I'm like, oh gosh, what are we going to do now? And Tom goes, oh, I think I have a spare. And so sure enough, he had a spare one of this component that we blew up, and he swapped them out and we were back in business. But that's the big difference between me and him, is I kind of go into these thinking, well, it's all going to be okay, and we'll figure it out. And Tom thinks about everything that could possibly go wrong and brings spares. So he's a really good guy to have around.
I remember that. That was impressive.
Yeah, it just blew me away that he actually had buried in all the stuff that we had carried to Russia, that he had the extra pieces that we need. And then I did another contest where I did get struck by lightning during the contest, and I don't really remember much about it. I just know I was running JAs like crazy, and then something happened, and the headphones are off, the headphones have flown off my head, the amplifiers turned off. I have no idea what happened, but when I walked into the house, the people that were staying with me, they said, man, you really look white. So that was an experience. But some of the best contest runs I've ever had have been in lightning storms, so I kind of hate to stop during them.
So Billy, can you top this?
I don't know, man. This is going to be tough. I think so actually I do have at least one of these, and Dan remembers this. This is the first time I went down to ZF with Dan, and we decided we didn't learn our lesson of how to sort of reduce the scope of these trips, of like all the things that we were planning on doing. But we had a lot of people that, you know, that came down with us, and we were going to replace an antenna, or sorry, put up two antennas, tri-banders. We were going to replace all of the switching in the shack. We were going to add all these new stack matches, you know, all just all of these things. And we had a, you know, very, you know, big, you know, I mentioned this, we had a very big group of people that wanted to do a multi-2, and man, we had nothing but bad luck. And I mean, you know, I got down there, you know, very early, but it turns out a lot of the stuff that we had shipped was stuck in customs. And we didn't get a lot of it, I want to say, until either Wednesday evening or Thursday morning, and decided to do all the stuff that we had sort of figured out would, you know, take a week, basically. And we had decided we were going to do it, you know, all in 24 hours. And, you know, we're climbing, you know, the towers, we're putting these antennas together, it's hot outside. And then the power company comes along and says, hey, we're going to replace all of the power poles around the station, like just ran, you know, so they turned the power off like all one of the days, you know. I'm in the dark in this, you know, in our little shack trying to solder pieces back together. I remember I'll never forget this. I was up on the tower trying to put a, you know, an antenna up, and N1C Marty walks outside. He says, hey Bill, I got good news and bad news. And I'm like, what? Yeah, he says, good news, you look really good up there on the tower. The bad news is we think we broke one of the amplifiers. So I got down, you know, and I think this was like Friday, you know, maybe an hour it'll kick off or something. You know, we tried to do surgery on the amplifier, but somehow, and I don't know how this is, we actually got on the air with a full multi two and played in the contest all weekend, and it was a very enjoyable experience. But I have to say, I really, you know, up until the end, it just seemed like there was no end to the rabbit hole of problems.
Do you enjoy any ham radio related activities beyond serious contesting?
Wow,
nothing. I think you just got the answer to that question.
No, not everybody answered once here.
What else is there? What do you mean?
Now, what is a ham radio related cool. activity? It related in what way? I mean, like, it's either ham radio or it's not ham radio. Which one is it?
Well, I think what the point is, DXing, DXpeditions, parks on the air, anything else?
I did traffic handling for quite a while when I was in high school, which is many good, great contesters came out of traffic handling because you were doing CW all the time and accuracy was important.
I've ended up in a few events where we did like support communications for like a 5K run or something like that. And that was a whole lot of fun. You know, we did that for a couple of years. We did this backcountry weekend thing for a couple of years at Henry Coast State Park and in just south of San Jose. And that was a whole lot of fun because we put a bunch of, you know, repeaters up to support the event, you know, in case somebody, there's just no cell service in this large area. So a lot of us would, you know, the hams were acting effectively as sort of the emergency communications network. And that was a lot of fun. But I think, you know, what I've really settled down in is just building things. Like I really enjoy, you know, taking apart radios and amplifiers and, you know, mostly it's just enable contesting, if I'm being completely honest. And I'm always kind of thinking like, okay, how can I, you know, make something better for the next contest. But, you know, I do have a lot of fun with that stuff.
Everything in ham radio is cool. Let's just put that out there. All of it.
Yes.
DXing is, or contesting is just competitive DXing in a short time period. You know, you get a thrill working a DX guy in a contest like you would day to day. And I love DXing. I just don't have a station to do it at home where I'd be on every day. So DXing is like this universal thing that ties everyone together. But I think VHF is super cool. If I lived in Central Europe, I'd probably have a giant VHF station. But the three guys I can work from middle of nowhere, Montana, is kind of boring. So I'm kind of jealous of these guys that can do VHF stuff. EME is super cool. I've done that. It's all cool. Working the satellites is cool. Talking to the space station is cool. Anything to do with ham radio is really interesting, and the technical side is my favorite side too.
Yeah, and I think that if I had more time and more skills, honestly, I think POTA is super cool. I know there's a lot of energy around that right now, and I think it sounds like a lot of fun. Both sides, being the activator and the one chasing the activator too. So I did something similar to that back in the day. You know, I mentioned it on the show a few times before, but I've done county hunting, and that was a big thing for me back when I was a teen. The main driver there again was my brother got USACA working all counties when he was 15. So I had this goal, I had to beat him. So I got it when I was 14. but you know, I spent a lot of time with county hunting. And to me, it's very similar to POTA and the fact that, you know, when you're out driving around in the middle of nowhere, and you go into these different counties, every time you get to a new one, all of a sudden you're rare. You have a pile up calling you. And I think, you know, even though I don't do it anymore, that's something that really shaped my overall operating when I was much younger. And I think it's been replaced now with POTA. And that's another thing that I think is very encouraging to see.
So I'm curious, when you do a contest, and obviously all you guys are at a very intense level, do you just not turn your radio on for a few days or couple weeks afterwards?
I used to never do that.
Yeah, yeah. That's usually how it works. It's
hard when you go to like K3LR or ND7K to come home to an attic dipole and a wire in the tree. It's like, oh man, this is just awful. I don't even want to get on.
Yeah, yeah. The attic dipole is still up here, but I don't think it's had RF in it for, I don't know, 7-6 years or something. Yeah, so as soon as you discover, you know, like a you know, a big station, it's like you can't operate that anymore.
So some of the stuff that I've done outside of, well, it's kind of outside and inside contesting, is all the work on administering contests, both WPX and CQ Worldwide. All the CQ, WPX, CQ160, CQVHF contest sites, I built all of those. And so just, you know, it's kind of a different, I'm not a technical guy, but I like doing programming kind of stuff and working on web things. And I love building antennas and tower climbing, that kind of thing. So it all fits together somehow.
The next question: for a new CW contester to the major events, what's typical in terms of error rate and percent of incorrect calls?
I've seen numbers all over the place. I don't think there's I don't think there's an easy way to answer this question, because it's very dependent on what your skills are and so on. But I've seen people have, even experienced guys have 10% error rates. I don't know whether they're drinking, they just can't hear very well, sloppy, whatever the case may be. But it doesn't really matter. It only matters what you do and can you make it better.
Yeah, we talked previously about what you do to, you know, adjust to these things you can do to get your error rate better. Practice your typing or practice your listening or make sure you get the 7 and 8 right and stuff like that. It's super important because, you know, we've all been on the receiving side of getting, you know, losing a contest because of your error rate. And we've also been on the other side where we win because of our error rate. Dan and I gained a couple places in 2010 in WRTC because of it. It's super important. So I try to, my goal is to be below 1%. I got 0.9% one time at TI7W, and I thought that was pretty cool for 11,000 Qs. I think anything under 2% is probably, you know, a world-class goal. Some of these guys always get less than that. These big time contesters, I could rattle off 100 calls, but anything under 2% is definitely a good goal. I think if you're a new contester, shoot for below 5%, and then just work from there and figure out what you've done wrong in your log checking report that are low hanging fruit to improve that, and then go from there.
In CQ Worldwide CW last year, the median score reduction for all logs was 8.8%. Now, that's often can be a little deceiving number, because if you bust a QSO that's a multiplier, it may have a larger impact on your score. But the median error rate for all logs was 2.67%. So median is the number where half are worse and half are better. So out of the 8,000 people who submitted a log, 4,000 of them had better than 2.67% error rate, and 4,000 of them had less. So that's the number to think about or have as a target.
And I think it's important to just, you know, reiterate here that if you are a new contester, don't feel bad if you have a really bad error rate in any particular contest. It's not that big of a deal. And like the others were saying, you know, the only thing that you can do from that is try and learn from it. But like, it's not something that you should, you know, feel poorly about if your error rate's high. We've all been there. It's going to happen, especially at the beginning. But as long as you're, you know, progressing and getting better over time, I think that's the main goal. But like, I wouldn't sit out the next contest if your error rate was too high or something like that. Just keep working at it. And I think that's a good way to look at it.
You know, when I first started CW, and it was only a couple years ago, you know, I remember when I said it was about 7, 8 years ago that I got started in contesting, and there was a couple of years before I said, okay, I really need CW to do another thing here. And I went through the, you know, CW Ops Academy and went through each of the levels. And even after the beginning, you know, the first beginning one, I actually, you know, went out with the Sharks and tried to play in CW contest. And yeah, boy, was that, I would say, not humiliating, but it was humbling. That's the word I was looking for. You know, I started off with error rates, and yeah, 10, I think 14% may have been the worst one ever. And you know, a lot of that was just me, you know, I kind of heard the call, maybe they had to repeat it several times, and maybe, you know, not super check partial, but, the pre-fill file helped a lot. And maybe I thought it sounded like that, but it didn't really. At some point, you do need to invest in accuracy. You can't you know, just sort of fund your way through it forever. And a lot of that was just, you know, honestly, just pure brute force of sitting over there with a Morse runner and Rusty and until you know, improve it a lot. And I agree with, like, you know, you're going to hit these plateaus too. It's going to be, you know, it'll be 5%, then it'll be 3%, then it'll be hovering in 2 for a little while. And it's just, it's pure experience, and it's purely sort of slowing down the listening. And sometimes it's even just an attention problem too. Like you might, or I guess even a, how willing are you to really invest in it? You know, you might just say, okay, it's good enough. And I'll you know, I'm not going to go through all this work anymore. But I would encourage you to see if you can stabilize in that sort of sub 2% range, and you know, and you can feel pretty good about it. Or, you know, if you're, you know, some people, like we've seen golden logs and, you know, 0.5% here and there. Those are just the absolute top of the crop.
So I think this next question definitely intersects. How many hours a week do you give to practicing your skills? And you allot time to learning equipment and software also?
Practicing for me is getting on the air and working guys in contests. I don't really do anything outside of the contest to try to do skill building. But because I operate almost every contest every weekend, some piece of it, you always learn something every time. For me, it's more about learning call signs and operating patterns and practices and so on than it is, you know, figure out how to use the logging software or type better.
It always depends on, you know, what contest we're talking about. I know a lot of people know that me and Chris prepare a lot for CQ Worldwide CW and we do it, so I'll touch on that just a little bit. So when it comes to that, we've mentioned before, we generally start in July. It's always been like the 4th of July has been like the standard starting point. And I personally would spend, you know, maybe half an hour a day practicing. And that's a combination of two things. That would be RUFZ or Morse Runner or both. And we would spend a ton of time almost every day getting on. And the reason why we spent all that time doing this is it's extremely difficult to do 2 BSIQ or even 3 radios when your rate is going to be over, you know, 350 or 400. If you don't practice, it's never going to happen. You just can't do it. And so if we're going to invest a lot of money and time into doing a contest like CQ Worldwide CW from a big station, and we want to try and win that one, there's only way to do it is to spend that much time. Now, if somebody is doing just like a regular contest, like this year, I'm doing a lot of contests from Arizona. I'm not practicing hardly at all outside of the contests. Like, the rates are not there in Arizona. I mean, we get lots of rate, but not 400 an hour. So it's not as important for me to spend all that extra time practicing because, you know, when you practice that much, it does take a little bit away from family and whatnot. And I try and avoid that when I can, when it's not necessary. But I think the best thing that you can do if you're not willing to do things like RUFZ and Morse Runner is just getting on the air, whether it be in a contest or not. That's always going to help you get better.
I think getting on the air is the best way. The reason Dan and I practice that way is because you can't replicate that getting on the air on 40 meters at 7 o'clock at night. You just can't. But if you're just learning and you're just getting your CW speed, or you just want to get used to stuff, your own station, your software, getting on the air is the way to do it. I will say that having hosted a few multi-ops now and of course been to 1,000 of them, learning the software is probably the number one thing that people struggle with, and it's really, honestly, it's a rate killer and it's an enjoyment killer. If you're not familiar with the software when you sit down to hit F1, you're already behind. So learn your software, especially if you're going to go to as a guest op, learn their software and be familiar with it. Otherwise, you're honestly starting behind, and getting catch up is just going to be frustrating.
Yeah, that's so right, Chris. So first of all, I mean, as far as like the practicing regimen, you know, remember, I'm still, you know, definitely not as experienced as a lot of these other guys are. But for at least for CW and pilot practice, for me, that's about, you know, call it 3 to 5 days a week, at least 30 minutes a day, generally in 10 minute increments. And, you know, at work, I'll do a Morse runner session like right before a meeting or something like that if I just happen to have 10 minutes to spare. And usually what I'm also trying to do is I'm trying to crank it up to the point where it's a struggle. So like, you know, I sort of want to be behind the pileup. I want there to be so many people calling that, you know, so many virtual callers that I can barely, you know, pull it out, or, you know, with rough C, I want to just be right at my limit so that it's sort of forcing me to just do, you know, work a little harder, because the goal is that the practice should be harder than the real thing if you're really, you know, expanding. Now, as far as the software is concerned, yes. I mean, like, I invest a ton of time in just, you know, loading these programs up and trying to learn as much as I can about them. I mean, I can walk into a multi-op and I'm honestly can say that I'm very comfortable with DXLog, Win-Test, and 1mm, you know, doesn't matter what, or, you know, write log, anything that they throw at me, especially if I, you know, I'll even ask them, you know, what are you using? And I'll make sure that I know that this is what I need to know. And usually I'll spend enough time on it. You know, I mean, I have a software background, so it's not that hard. I mean, I want to be able to, you know, fix problems without waking somebody up. I want to be able to, you know, I want to know some of the shortcuts that the software offers. I want to just, you know, be used to it. And I mean, I'll even remember like the first time I started using Win-Test and trying like my N1MM key combos in it, you know, it didn't work so well. But eventually, you know, learning DXLog, I've actually, you know, grown to prefer it just because I spent that much time learning all the ins and outs and what it's capable of. And, you know, once you really invest in learning a logging program, I think it pays dividends considerably. Same deal with a radio, you know, a brand new radio. Like I've got these, you know, K4s behind me. And, you know, when they first came in, I just sat there for probably, you know, call it 8 hours, and I pushed every button and read about every function and, you know, just tried to just get a good understanding of like, okay, I didn't necessarily remember it all after that, but I kind of had an idea of, okay, these are the sort of things that are going to trip me up. These are the sort of the things that I'm going to use all the time. I got to, you know, make sure that I know how to do that. And you know, again, I think that's very important.
So once again, we're not going to get through all the questions, so we'll end on this last one. How has your contesting experience changed over the years? Has your attitude toward contesting changed?
Well, I think we're all competitive people. And our desire to compete and win has probably gone up, not down, as our experience and opportunities have increased. So I'll say what I do think is when contesting was new and fresh, it was a lot easier to do the hard work of that you have to do to win a contest, to do the prep work and stay awake the whole time. As you are in it longer, speaking for myself, I no longer have that. I still like to win and I still will do all that I can, but I don't go into it going, must operate 48 hours. it's just not quite as intense. And I'll often find myself now getting pretty far into a contest and going, wow, you know, I don't know if this is that much fun anymore. But my attitude toward contesting hasn't changed at all. My ability to do it, it may be going down.
Well, I think, you know, when I was younger, I didn't really understand these guys that were like, you know, getting out of competitive contesting, you know, these guys that had set every record and done all the things. And I will say maybe in the last 5 years, I was like, oh, yeah, I get it. That's a lot of work. You don't really need to put in anymore. Like, what do you have left to prove? You can still have fun. You don't have to kill yourself. It's great. So I totally get that. I'm with Randy that putting in the work to be hyper competitive doesn't have the reward and the return that it used to. Everyone has their contesting bucket list. And as you check those things off, they become less important. My attitude's changed a ton because I've loved the station building side and the technical side, which I never could do before. So I focused on the operating side and I've gotten more competitive than ever for sure. But in the short term, I don't do 48 hours anymore for various reasons. So I focus my energy on something I can do. And I think it's made me more into contesting than ever before, which is a good thing. And I've gotten more into the people side of it and the relationships and hanging out with the guys at a multi-op and, you know, going to St. Kitts with Randy and Andy and, you know, doing these things with Bill and Dan. And the social aspect is way more important to me than the operating side now, even though if I lose, I still hate it.
Yeah. And just to kind of piggyback on that last comment, you know, for me too, it's also the social aspect. I think that when I was first starting out, like I was super into the single op thing and, you know, trying my best to set records. And now it's definitely changed. The other thing too, that's also changed is I've learned over time to, be choosy in which contests that you do, especially as I've gotten older, have a family, have a wife, have a son. The priorities have shifted. Now, everybody knows that contesting is a big part of my life, so I get away with more than I probably should. But I also have to realize that, you know, doing Worked All Europe sideband this last weekend, I'm extremely happy that I didn't do it because, you know what, I spent a lot of time with my wife, had a great time, and the condition sucked. And so not being forced to do stuff like that has definitely changed. And then the last thing I want to comment is, you know, all of us here on this call or in this chat here, we're all, you know, giving our time to have these conversations. And I think a lot of that has to do with, you know, we want to help others get better at this hobby, right? And that's something that I've definitely tried to do more so than I have in the past is, you know, sharing my experiences with others so that they can learn from them as well. Because I want others to be able to do some of these things that we do too. And if we don't share what we're doing, then, you know, we lose that ability.
I guess several of the times I've tried to explain to people, you know, what is this contesting thing and why do you, you know, why is it, you know, so much fun? And, you know, I even have trouble understanding sometimes when I'm explaining to, you know, a coworker or a friend or somebody that's not involved, like, what do you mean? You can't possibly understand how much fun this is. You can't possibly understand what a rush this entire thing is, and why, you know, why anybody would ever want to do it. I mean, you know, by the time you're done describing it, they think you're nuts. And but that is just the reason. You know, Dan's exactly right. That's exactly the reason that a lot of us are here is because we want to get more people involved. And I started off similarly. When I first started off, I was trying to just get in every contest, get a bunch of experience, and there was a certain point where I realized that, oh my, you know, this is not compatible with I guess life as we know it, and it's also not compatible with the social aspect, which I think is far more rewarding. You know, getting to know Chris and Dan and Tim and Marty and a bunch of other people that are sort of in the circle of you know, crazy people that also happen to enjoy this. I've really, you know, figured out that, you know, multi-op is in many ways almost always more enjoyable than a single op staying up for, you know, God knows how many hours and nearly falling over.
As we close up this call, I'd like everybody to know that we spent a lot of time putting together a 2025 schedule that will include pre-contest shows, post-contest wrap-ups, very specific focuses on different subjects. But I guess I'm curious, and I want to close with asking all of you guys, the contest crew, is there anything you'd like to ask of our watchers, things that would be helpful to hear from them so that you stay encouraged to do this through 2025?
Well, they should call in every contest, and they should stay off my frequency otherwise.
That's it.
Yeah, spot me, call me.
Tell your friends. Yeah. I'd be curious to know what people have done based off our advice to help them either improve their scores or improve their experience and enjoy things a little more. Because, you know, like Dan said, we do this for people in the hobby and to do this, but we only do that because we love it so much. And maybe our enthusiasm doesn't quite come through on here, but if you talk to Dan one-on-one about contesting, he gets all twitchy and he gets all excited. And that enthusiasm, you know, you can't replicate that. It's a passion. And we want to get guys to see that passion because it's way more rewarding than it sounds like when you talk to a coworker in the lunchroom and they're like, Bill said, you know, you're crazy. Yeah, we are crazy, but it's awesome.
It's great to be crazy.
There's no question. The feedback is wonderful. I've had a number of people comment on the show, and it's just number one, nice to know that people are listening, and number two, that they're learning something. I love the feedback where somebody says, "Hey, I did something different because of what you said." That's what we want. That's what we want to hear.
Yeah, that's awesome.
And to be clear, we've gotten a lot of great feedback, and we appreciate that. But the bottom line is, we'd like to hear more feedback, more questions. Tell us the topics you'd like us to talk about. Thanks for joining us. This has been W1DED with the Contest Crew. Thank you for joining us.